Welcome, graduates, parents, family, and friends, to Redland Christian Academy 2015 graduation ceremony. We're going to begin tonight with a prayer from Mr. Daniel Carrillo.
Praise God. I hope you guys believe in miracles, because I see a whole bunch of them right there. Let's pray. Dear God, we lift up your name. Father, we thank you so much for this night. God, I pray in Jesus' name that tonight we can celebrate, Lord, the awesome year that you've given these students. I pray that you bless every parent, every family member, every friend that's here tonight, Lord. And we just pray, God, that we can relish in the joy of celebrating tonight. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
There's a saying that I know you all have heard that's a great piece of advice. Leave it better than you found it. This is often used to talk about a physical place. If you rent a banquet hall, you're responsible to return it the way that it was, but you're especially admired if you make it even better than how you found it. More than that, it can be used to describe your interactions with people. During kindergarten graduation this year, Ms. Cabrera read a quote that I found out is a quote from Mother Teresa. It says, "Let no one ever come to you without leaving better and happier. Be the living expression of God's kindness. Kindness in your face, kindness in your eyes, and kindness in your smile." I've been thinking about how individuals can make a place better as I think about this group of graduates. They are most definitely leaving RCA better than they found it. As a group, they've been exemplary leaders. They've moved through our hallways with grace and kindness. For the most part, because none of us are perfect, we've admired their choices, and we've asked other students to follow in their footsteps. And graduates, as you go forward into life, you can continue this legacy. First, you need to know that it will be continued here at RCA. We treasure knowing that you are forever part of the RCA family. Second, you can build this reputation in your upcoming adventures if you follow the advice from Philippians 2, 3 through 4. And that says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each to the interests of others." This snippet of advice from the scriptures is part of a larger passage that's really about modeling yourself after Christ. His willingness to sacrifice everything so that we could live with God can be a strong anchor in your life. Each season of your life will require you to choose how you interact with others. You can consider your own interests, and I predict you'll have a life full of strife. Or you can consider the interests of others, and you can live with the peace that you'll be reflecting Christ in your college, in your job, in your marriage, in your parenthood, and even in your struggles and your trials. Recently, a quote from one of my husband's favorite movies came to my attention, and when I heard it, I thought of you. The movie is Shawshank Redemption. If you're not familiar with the movie, it's about a man named Andy who is wrongly convicted and sentenced to life in prison. While he was there, he earned the respect of everyone, including the warden, and he brought about many improvements in the experiences of the other inmates. Now, And at the end of the movie, he escapes from prison. I hope that you are not so desperate to leave here that you would dig a hole through a concrete wall. And I'm not comparing high school to prison. I actually think high school is a pretty great place to be, and especially Redland Christian Academy. The setting and the circumstances of the hero are not the parts that made me think of you. It's the following quote. When speaking about Andy, his friend Red says, Sometimes it makes me sad, though, Andy being gone. I have to remind myself that some birds aren't meant to be caged. Their feathers are just too bright. And then when they fly away, the part of you that knows it was a sin to lock them up does rejoice. But still, the place you live in is that much more drab and empty that they're gone. I guess I just miss my friends. And that is how I feel about you. I rejoice with you as you enter a new chapter of your lives. And I grieve that you will not be here anymore to brighten our experience. I love you. Congratulations. I'm pleased to present our commencement speaker, Mrs. Janellis Bryant.
So when Ms. Bergman first asked me to address you guys, I accepted without hesitation. I was like, these are my babies. This is going to be so easy. And then I sat down to write the speech, and I was like, I have nothing. I had nothing to say to you because I've been bombarding these poor children with advice for the last 2 years. Throughout the summer and pretty much every single day of the school year, they were receiving messages from me and advice, and that's what I'm supposed to be doing here today. And so I've exhausted every cliche that exists, and they've heard every single "today is the day" quote. So I decided that instead of giving you advice today, I'm going to take a step back, and I'm going to share with your family all the things that you guys have taught me. So about 6 weeks into last school year, I gathered a group of students that were interested in like higher education. They were juniors and seniors, and we went to Barry University. We took a trip, and it was great. We were there for like 10 hours, and it was lots of fun. And on the way back, most of the students were tired. They started to fall asleep on the bus. So everybody's falling asleep, and Nicholas and Michael creep their way to the front of the bus, and they sit right next to me. And so it's quiet, and it's cold, and it's dark. And Michael turns to me, and he's like, "Miss, truth time." And so I freaked out, because I was like, what could two 16-year-old boys possibly be approaching me with after a 10-hour field trip that starts with the expression "truth time" that could be any good? But instead of admitting that they've committed this terrible crime, Michael looks at me and he said, "You know, when we first met you, we couldn't stand you." What? And Nick says, "Yeah, you took my phone away on the first day." And Michael comes back and he says, no, it's not that. We kind of thought you were stuck up." So it took me a second to compose myself and decide what the appropriate response was. But before I could even respond, they went on to explain that they were making this admission to me because they wanted to tell me how wrong they felt they were. And this led to a conversation about the future and about what kind of attitudes help us to be successful adults. And it led to conversation about family and about their parents and about truth and about love. And it just ended really great. And as they regressed and started to fall asleep and start paying attention to their cell phones and their music, I realized I had kind of done the same thing about them. I had only known them for a really short period of time. And I had assumed that they like to test authority and that they were a little bit overly confident for kids their age. But in reality, they were just these really great, humble kids that were struggling with the reality of becoming adults. And so I learned, again, for probably too many times in my life, that you shouldn't judge a book by its cover. And that in addition to not judging a book by its cover, you need to be aware of what your cover is showing and make sure that it's accurately reflecting what you have inside. And so this conversation led to many future conversations with these two kids and a lot of the students at RCA. And Nick in particular struggled this year with a pretty major decision. He was presented with a job opportunity that would regularly only be offered to an adult. And it came with adult responsibilities and adult schedules and all types of things. And so Nicholas is a really mature kid, and he's very ambitious. And so the idea of living in an adult world, it excited him. It made him happy, and he was so excited about this opportunity. But because of the schedule, this opportunity also meant that he would probably have to give up high school baseball. And so he came to talk to me because he was just so torn. Like, baseball had been so much of his identity here in high school. And so we spoke about the benefits and the pros and cons of both, and we spoke about what his heart felt and what his mind felt. And then Nicholas went home to make a decision, and he came back the next day, and he said to me, "I would be miserable with either decision, and so I'm going to find a way to compromise." And he did. He spoke to his boss, and he spoke to his baseball coaches, and he found a way to benefit his future while enjoying his present. And as adults, we're always thinking of the future. We're always thinking of the next vacation and the next holiday and the next school year and the next 5 pounds and the next, just everything. That it's always the next. And sometimes we forget to stop and enjoy what's actually going on in front of us. And Nicholas served as a reminder that it's okay to do both. You can plan for the future without having to sacrifice the present. It's been a really emotional year for all the kids. They're growing up, and they're making decisions, and they're forming relationships. And for Emily, on one specific day, she was having a bit of a hard day, and she came to me, and she was crying. And she told me what was on her heart, and for a long time, she cried. We cried together, and for what seemed like hours, I know it was only like 10 minutes, but it seemed like hours because I felt so bad. She was crying, and then she said, excuse me. She went to the bathroom and she washed her face, or I don't know, like performed some sort of magic spell. But when she came out, she was this completely different person. She was confident, and she was okay. And she said to me, "I've survived much more than this. I'm going to be okay." Okay. So she... Every creative writing assignment I've ever given Emily, everything that she has the opportunity to speak from her heart, including her post-high school decision to go into the medical field, is about her medical history. It's about her medical past. But she takes that history and she makes it an identity. She's a survivor. And she's proof that our past doesn't have to make us weak, it makes us strong. I remember sitting in class one day on another occasion, and the students were turning in their assignments to me, and I heard a conversation start between like a group of boys, and Jordan was one of those boys, and they were like over here. And so I heard the conversation going on, and as students were turning in their assignments to me, and I was grading them, and I was talking to the students, I was keeping a close ear on them to make sure that the conversation stayed where it had to stay. And they were discussing one of their peers. It was another student that was a team member on one of the sporting events with them. And the other students were showing distaste for this student's actions. So they were complaining about this student and about the way that this student behaves during their sporting events and the way that he lashes out. And Jordan said, in a really, really wise and mature voice, he said, "It's clear that he doesn't have the same benefits of a family life than we do. So instead of showing him more aggression, we need to show him more love." And Jordan, the conversation stopped because you really can't say anything back to that. And from that point on, I saw one student in particular change the way that they acted towards the teammate that they were speaking about. And Jordan's comment, his admission, proves that even though our past should make us stronger, it does affect who we are. And part of being human beings and part of society we need to acknowledge others' past and how it can affect them and their personalities, and we need to be empathetic. And in addition to being empathetic to others' past, we need to find ways to fill voids for those that are struggling. At the beginning of the school year, Keandra was completely and utterly dead set on having a cheerleading team at the school. I had decided that this year I wasn't going to sponsor the cheerleading team because it was just a lot considering my schedule. So Keandra rounded up a group of girls and they rallied. And they were willing to do absolutely anything possible to make sure that this activity can take place. This included having before school practices at 6 a.m. every morning. I agreed. Keandra's will and her desire to do something encouraged me to agree. Shortly after then, her home life changed a little bit and she no longer had a ride to practice. So I offered her a ride, but that meant waking up at 5 in the morning and being ready and set to go to practice. And she was. Later in the every time, by the way, she was like ready and there to go. Later in the school year, she got a job. And it worked her to the bone. She had long hours, and it added to an already crazy schedule. And Keandra managed to maintain an AB honor roll the entire year. So even with 5 a.m. practices and working and all of these different things that she had to endure, Keandra is proof that diligence and hard work is what you need to be successful, and that things just don't come easily to people. You have to work hard for them. Eddie is an incredibly, incredibly helpful young man. He's helpful in a way that's not common to most people. He's actually helpful in a way that's a complete anomaly to people his age. If something needs to be moved, Eddie moves it. If something needs to be organized, Eddie organizes it. If someone needs help getting to their locker, Eddie helps them. There's no questions, there's no comments. Eddie does it. In every single senior-related event that we've had that have other adults have been present that aren't used to the dynamic of the seniors, somebody comments, man, that kid is so helpful. That kid is so great. The students themselves have commented on how he always takes initiative to help. And so as I was thinking of that, I thought, I've never thanked him. I've never stopped, ever, to thank you. So before I continue, thank you, Eddie. Your strong hands and your stronger will to help, it's a reflection in everything that you do. And all the career choices that have been made, or like potential career choices that have been amongst your peers, they all make sense. They all fit your personality, but yours, it's perfect. You have a servant's heart, and you're going to take that servant's heart and you're going to use it to be a community server, and you're going to be an amazing firefighter, and I'm so proud of you. Okay? But Eddie serves as a reminder that sometimes in life, we don't get the thanks that we deserve. Actually, it's my experience, and even especially upon reflecting on him, that the more that you do something or the better you are at it, the more it's expected and the less it's appreciated. And one of the lessons to learn from Eddie is that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're receiving the thanks or if you're receiving the praise that you feel you deserve. You keep serving and you keep using your gifts. So I haven't had the pleasure of spending long periods of time with Rudy. So because I know he's so great and I felt that he needed a wonderful description today, I went to someone who has. So I asked Mr. Calderon, hey, I'm going to talk about lessons that the students have taught me. What can you say Rudy has taught you? And he said this. Mr. Calderon, by the way, for those of you who don't know, is Rudy's former teacher. He said, Rudy has the ability to put others before himself. Putting others first comes naturally to him. If you're lucky enough to be his friend, he will always be right by your side. He will laugh at your jokes, even if no one else will, and he will walk with you. That's true, apparently. Okay, so he will walk with you even if no one else does. He will do whatever it takes to ensure your comfort. He's bold, and it makes him an honest and a true friend. He has no problem seeking you out if he feels that you're hurting, and he has no problem asking for a hug if he's the one hurting. He has no problem telling girls that he likes them. Perhaps a little too boldly sometimes. He said that, not me. And he has no problem telling you that he's your friend and he loves you. In a society where boys wearing their hearts on their sleeves is not the most popular thing to do, and maybe even the scariest because of the uncertainty that they will be loved in return, I would say it's pretty courageous. Rudy, you are a reminder that our emotions are not meant to be hidden, and wearing your heart on your sleeve is actually the bravest way to live. Kenya has only been part of RCA for a very short time. She's sweet and respectful, and she's quiet as a mouse. She doesn't talk very often, but I feel very fortunate because I have had the great blessing of being let into her life through conversations that she and I have shared. I've had the privilege to pray for her, and through her, I've learned that strength is not always loud. It's not always flashy. She's a reminder that sometimes strength comes from a quiet place, but it's powerful just the same. Oh boy. Okay, so I've known Gabriel since I first started at RCA 5 years ago. He was actually the first student outside of my self-contained class, or one of the first students, that I had a personal relationship with, you know? He wasn't in my class, but for extracurricular reasons, we knew each other. And so I have countless stories that are a reflection of Gabriel's heart and a reflection of his spirit. But one stands out to me because of its boldness. It may be hard to believe, but when we first started the cheerleading team here, I had 5 boys and 2 girls. Gabriel was one of those boys. So we used to call it the acro team so that, like, they felt better about it or whatever. But, the acro team, that's what we're going to go with. So during that first year, we went to a cheerleading convention. It was the Christian Cheerleaders of America, and it was in Tampa. And we took all our boys and our 2 girls, and we traveled up to Jacksonville. And we walked into this building that was this huge gymnasium full of, like, pleated skirts and perfect bows and glitter and sprinkles. And we walked in with our 5 boys in, like, hip-hop pants and matching red shirts and our 2 girls who were equally street savvy. And so it was clear that we didn't belong, and it was clear that we were from South Florida. It was just, we were different. The kids walked in, and aside from the fact that a couple of the girls were, like, blushing and stuff because the boys had swag and it was different from the culture of their sport, they fit right in. They went ahead and they did all the activities that they had to do as part of the training camp. And right before lunch, like in the middle of the day, they stopped all physical activity and they had everyone sit down for a devotional. And the devotional was given by the Christian Cheerleaders of America. It was a really powerful devotional about how we wear masks to hide our true selves from our peers and our community because we're so concerned about how people think. And I was watching from the back with Mr. Angry and Coach Carr and Coach Bindukamara, who had gone with us, and we were watching, like, all these kids who grew up in these really strict religious households and who were clearly financially well off, and they were, like, laughing through it, and they were, like, on their phones, and they were kind of messing around. And our kids, but especially Gabriel, were watching, and they were listening, and they were respectful, and they were attentive. And at the end of their devo, the coaches giving the presentation said that they wanted anyone in the audience that was ready to take off their mask and, like, live for Jesus and show that they wanted to have Jesus in their heart, they wanted them to stand up. So you have this room of, like, 300 girls and maybe like 50 boys all together. And they're all standing there and nobody moves. It's like 10 seconds. And 10 seconds into it, Gabriel takes everything off his lap, and he stood up. And he stood up all by himself for a good 10 seconds. And one by one, they started to join. Coach Christy turned to me and she said, "One of my daughters is marrying that kid." And that's who Gabriel is. He will stand up for what is right 100% of the time. He's the first to stand up for what is right every time, and he's the last to care what anybody thinks about it. He's a leader, and he is a reflection of how we should live. He does what is right, and others follow him because it is right. So with this class and with the current 11th grade class, I have like this habit, this reputation of going off on a tangent. They kind of know how to get to me, and so they know that I really like to talk about the human body. So in the middle of a lesson that they don't want to do, they'll like ask me a question because they know that I'll answer it and I'll talk about it for 10 minutes. And I always get them back, like I always make it a research paper or something, but they do get me. I do go off on a tangent. And so I'm presenting you guys with your last Miss Bryant tangent of your academic career. Ready? The human body has 37 trillion cells. These cells are the basic unit of life. In essence, they are the building blocks of all living things. Each cell has a size and a shape that is suited to do its job. Cells that do the same job combine together to form body tissue, such as muscle and skin. And groups of different types of cells make up the organs in our body, such as hearts and liver, your liver, and your lungs. These 37 trillion cells have a function in your body. But if they're not in the correct place, they can actually be harmful to your health. There is one specific molecule that holds everything in its place. It's an adhesion molecule that literally holds your body together. And it looks like this. It's called the laminin. It looks like this. This is true for us as well. There are 7 billion people in the world, and we're all different shapes, and we're all different colors. We have different gifts and different talents, but it's a cross that holds us together. As you go into the world and you leave RCA behind, think about the people that you've met here. Think about your friends and the teachers. Think about the lessons that they've indirectly taught you. Remember to never judge a book by its cover. People are so much more than they appear to be. Get to know their hearts before you form an opinion about them. You will be pleasantly surprised every time. But keep in mind that everyone will not have the same wisdom as you. And you do need to, and you will be judged on first impressions. So always keep your best foot forward and do everything that you can do. The two students who judged me by my cover are two of the students that I have had the most amazing personal relationship with in my entire career. They are students that give me mutual respect and love and encouragement, and I'm blessed to know them. So make sure you don't judge that book. Plan for your future. It's necessary for part of your success, but if you're always dying to get to the next phase of your life, you will look back and realize that you never really lived. So take the necessary steps to ensure that you're also enjoying your present. Don't let your past define you. Make sure it makes you stronger. Remember that you never know what someone else is going through. Use empathy and understanding when dealing with difficult people. Your kindness may be the difference in their lives. Diligence is an absolute necessity for success. If you want something, you have to work hard to get it. Things that come easily are taken away easily. Never stop using your gifts. You will probably never get credit for the things that you deserve. Do them anyways. Wear your heart on your sleeve. Being vulnerable and open with your emotions is not a sign of weakness, it's a sign of strength. Strength and success are not always loud and flashy. In a world driven by social media and unfair comparisons, remember that only one person knows your heart. It's God, and only his opinion matters. Be bold and take a stand. Be a leader. Show the world that being genuine is more important than being popular. And last, but definitely not least, as you encounter different kinds of people in your lives, remember that we're all connected by one thing. regardless of their beliefs, regardless of their opinions. We are all connected by Christ's love. You have an entire school, Fabio, like an entire school of people rooting for you. You've made history in here. You lived up to your slogan. We can't wait to see what you do out there. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mrs. Bryant. Last week, I had a student approach me and said, "Ms. Bergman, I want to say thank you at graduation. I want to have the floor." And I said, "Okay, because I think you're going to be blessed to hear what Emily Sierra has to say."
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I want to start by saying thank you to RCA for how much you have done for me. I have been here for over 13 years, and I have had many challenges during the years at RCA. I had to deal with many personal struggles. I have been through many open-heart surgeries. Throughout those trying times, I had an immense amount of support from family, friends, and staff members at RCA. When I was in the third grade, Mrs. Smith had everyone in the class make a get-well card for me. And one year, the whole school made a giant get-well card for me while I was in the hospital, and everyone signed it with many prayers. Receiving that meant so much to me. The support I received from my Falcon family made an everlasting difference. I owe that to all the loved ones I had by my side. Because of that, I'm here on June 5th, 2015, not only alive and well, but also graduating high school. Thank you to everyone for all the prayers, love, and support. I am forever grateful to be standing here today in my home and by my family. And I would like to wish a happy birthday to my little sister. Thank you all.
Now I present to you your salutatorian, Michael Salas.
Hey, so before I start, I want to take a selfie. So if everyone could smile. Hello. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Before I begin speaking to you, I must thank God for everything He has done in my life. This moment, graduating, being salutatorian, standing in front of you, a healthy and strong young man, would not have been possible without him. God has played the most important role in my life for the 15 years I've been in the school and the 18 years I've been alive. He has been the constant in my life. I am so grateful for him, for the ability to praise him openly. Thank you. Fellow classmates, today is an important day in all our lives. We gather here today to celebrate more than a decade of learning, overcoming hardships, and celebrating victories together. We're surrounded by all the people who taught us and inspired us throughout our lives. God, our parents, oh my goodness, our parents, our family members, our teachers, and our friends. Graduating high school is an achievement that only happens once in our life. You only get to choose your college or your vocational school you're going to attend once. You only get to choose your first job once. You'll move on and you will grow. But just as RCA has shaped us, wherever you go after here will shape your future. So no pressure. Redland Christian Academy has been my family's home for more than 20 years. It started with my older cousins, Jasmine Rodriguez and Robbie Vargas. These two proved to be very challenging for the former principals, Mrs. Curry and Mrs. Wildbilly. No matter how much they misbehaved or what they had done, they always made sure I didn't do their same mistakes. Case in point, when I was in the third grade, I had the honor of being in Mrs. Smith's class. Although I enjoyed her, I really, really, really disliked school. And I really, 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 really disliked homework. There was nothing I hated more than homework. The entire school year, I hadn't turned in a single assignment. Mrs. Smith was an excellent teacher, but I was excellent at doing nothing. I was the world's laziest third grader. I had much more important things to do, like watch TV or watch pointless videos on YouTube. Wait, now I think about it, not much has changed. Mrs. Smith told me countless times, if I continue to miss assignments, I will fail the year. I never listened to her, and I had no intention of doing so. Fast forward to the last few weeks of the year, Mrs. Smith told me that my actions had consequences. Because of my lack of efforts, I would have to repeat the third grade, and there was nothing for me to do about it. My mom was angry, of course. Boy, was she angry. But the one person who was completely taken aback was my cousin Jasmine. My mom and Jasmine pleaded with Mrs. Smith to give me a break. In true Mrs. Smith fashion, she didn't budge. She gave me the opportunity to pass, but only if I completed every single assignment from the entire year. I'm sure that there are a few things that frustrate a teacher more than having to grade makeup work turned in by a careless student. I knew my work had to be flawless. I didn't want to fail, but I also didn't want to do all the incomplete work from an entire school year. I lost myself. Oh, yeah. From that point on, Jasmine was on a mission to help me complete my work. If not for her, I likely would have reverted to my YouTube watching ways. But she didn't let that happen. Jasmine would transform her bedroom into a very young classroom. During the day, she was Jasmine, but when it was time to have class, she was Miss Rodriguez. This went on until all my work was completed. This took weeks. Fortunately, with my mom and Jasmine's commitment to help me, we succeeded. And I was able to pass the very difficult and time-consuming third grade crash course. Third grade stands out to me because it was the first real accomplishment I made. The first time I really had to work hard at something. The first time I truly appreciated the result of my hard work. To this day, I couldn't be more grateful for my mom, Jasmine, and Mrs. Smith. Without them, I probably will still be in the third grade. As a result, I learned to save the YouTube videos and reruns until after my work was done. And my mom learned to harass my teachers on a weekly basis to assure I wasn't missing a single assignment. Thanks, Mom. As absurd as it may sound, I'm glad I had to go through that stressful situation. I'm glad it happened at such a young age. I strongly believe success is not how many times you fall, but how many times you stand back up. RCA has taught me the importance of hard work and the benefit of actually listening to your teachers. Whether we wanted to accept it or not, I think they have made it clear that their goal is to help us and want us to succeed in life. Our teachers have bachelor's, master's, and even doctoral degrees. They could have chosen any field. They could have chosen any workplace. They have great minds in higher education, yet they decided to teach us about academics and, more importantly, the importance of God. I salute every teacher at RCA for his or her time of service and for always being there for us. At this time, I would like to thank every teacher who has had the absolute wonderful privilege to teach me and my peers. The first teacher I ever had at the ripe age of 3 years old was Mrs. Cabrera. Where's Ms. Cabrera? Somewhere. Mrs. Cabrera is the sweetest yet most stern kindergarten teacher out there. I don't remember much from her class because I was 3 years old. But I can say from memory and observation that she teaches with the perfect combination of tenderness and energy. I love being in her class, and I love watching her class now. Her class is where a love for learning is planted in young minds. It might be only a seed when she plants it, but it blossoms with love and watering we receive through the years into something that is truly magnificent. Thank you for all you did and for all that you do. I have already discussed Mrs. Smith, but I would like to say a few more words to her. I cannot begin to put into word what third grade was like in your class. Your class is just an adventure all around. Even to this day, I can honestly say you were the single strictest teacher I ever had. I was scared every morning before I would walk into your classroom because you would always ask me if I did my homework, and the answer I always gave was, of course, no. Now that I'm a little bit, very little bit, more mature, I understand fully why you have to be so tough. Even if I didn't understand it then, you showed us the direction to success. You take your job very seriously because you know what it takes to be successful and to accomplish something in life. Thank you for all you did. Believe it or not, your class is what woke me up from not caring. If not for that scare, I likely wouldn't be standing here today, salutatorian and on my way to college. Miss Keating, the few years we had with you were a blast. We generally learned so much in your class, and we will always have a good laugh. There are too many memories for me to just pick one, but I'm really thankful for all the years we had together. Mr. Antiola, I don't know if he's here or not, but Mr. Antiola, known as Mr. A, was a worthy replacement for Miss Keating. You're one of the funniest teachers I've ever met, and there has never been a dull moment. I'm going to miss your class not only because of your corny jokes or your crazy magic tricks, but because of your sense of humor and your caring. The last two grading periods have been a lot of fun, and I'm thankful for all you did and all that we've learned. Dr. Ruffin, there wasn't a single day in your class where you weren't laughing hysterically. You're so funny, and your class brightens up everyone's day. You're one of the closest teachers I've ever had. I've been able to go to you for advice on very personal circumstances that were happening in my life. I want to thank you for you and your trust. You are very observant, and you are very careful who you trust and talk to. And for that, I thank you. Thank you for always being there for me. Audric isn't here, but I still wanted to say something about him. Even though you've been in Alaska for the last year riding polar bears, huskies, and living in igloos, I couldn't thank the influential people in my life without thanking you. You were always like an older brother to me, always correcting me when I was wrong and always making fun of me when I never deserved it. I missed you this year, and I'm sad you've missed so much. You're one of the very few people I trust the most, and I'm super grateful for all the times we had. Thank you for all the memories. Mrs. Ramirez, there are no words to describe how grateful I am for your life. You are such an amazing woman of God, and you always told our class to trust in God and follow his ways. I'm so grateful for you because you showed us the real Mrs. Ramirez. You were always available through the tough times, and we were always available for you. Thank you for everything you've done, and we will always be your babies. Whew. Glad we got that out of the way. We're your babies too, Ms. Bryant. Mrs. Bryant, having you for the past 3 years have been super amazing. We've had fun in and out of school. With you, everything is always an adventure. No matter what the occasion or the circumstance, you taught us a lot about life, to always work hard and to always chase your dreams. I'm thankful for everything you've done for me and the senior class. We love you. Mr. C. There is no way to even begin to describe you and your class. You and I arrived at RCA at the same time, 15 years ago. You were my teacher in 4th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. You've seen me grow, and you've been a tremendous impact on my life. You're one of the wisest people I've ever met. You know about everything, and we would always go to you whenever there was a dispute or question we want to answer. Although, I still stand by my argument, candy is not food. Not seeing you and abiding by your many rules will be strange once we are gone for good. Your class will be the class I'll miss the most. I'm also thankful for the office staff, Ms. Tanya, Ms. Fiorella, Mrs. Kobo, and Mrs. Bergman. Thank you for all the girl talk I had to go through while being office aide. You have given me a true insight into the female mind. It's a scary place. I would have to leave sometimes because it was too much for my manly self to handle. But I learned a lot nonetheless. Being office aide was a lot of fun, and I'm going to miss it a lot. In addition to the fun times it provided, I am thankful for the opportunity to see the inner workings of the school, to experience firsthand how hard you all work. Mrs. Bergman, thank you for all you do at RCA. Being principal is a lot more difficult than what people think. Your job is so much more than any one person should have to handle. It is a really stressful job, and we want to thank you for always being there for us and our small problems when you have such big ones to face. Your work definitely does not go unnoticed. Mr. Mike Hoots, I'm going to miss you and your famous super loud Casting Crowns ringtone. There wasn't a single day where you were getting calls in the middle of Bible class. But in all seriousness, I know every single call you were answering was a call of service. Your entire life is about serving others. You will always help a person in need without hesitation, no matter what the occasion, you will always answer the call. Thank you for your service as a teacher and a minister. I would also like to thank my baseball coaches. Leo, you were there for us this year and on so many different occasions. Thank you for your presence and your encouragement. Coach Kenneth, you've only been with us for 2 years, but in those 2 years, you've become family. You're always there for us, and we can't thank you enough for everything you've done and all the sacrifices you've made for us. Coach Lied. You've been with us from day one. You've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly. That was never me, of course. We've won some, and we've lost some. But it was hard the first few years because we never played before, but you stuck with us until you finally made us champions. We lost against the same team for almost 3 years straight, but this year, we finally got you that trophy. Coach, you've always told us that you would treat us like sons, and you have. Many of my teammates lacked a strong father figure, and I couldn't think of a better man to fill a part of that void. I'll always be thankful for you and my team and for all the unforgettable memories. Being part of the team you started has truly been the highlight of my life. To my fellow graduates, you guys are my closest friends. It will be too time-consuming to mention everyone individually, but I would like to mention a few. Emily, we've been together for over 10 years, and you're one of my closest friends. We've been close friends for a long time, and I don't regret a single moment of our friendship, although I might regret some of the crazy things we've done. This was tough. Gabriel and Nick. Wow. I guess I've never made this declaration out loud, but you guys are my true best friends.
Oh my God!
Oh, no. I told myself that wouldn't happen. I never made this declaration out loud, but you guys are my true best friends. I feel like the term best friends is overused and not always necessary to say. I can't speak. But I want you to know how deeply I feel it. You guys, oh my goodness. You guys mean a lot to me, and I can't imagine a better team of friends. We irritate each other, we love each other, and we make each other laugh. We've been playing baseball together since the start. We've grown up in so many ways. Last week, it hit me that soon our daily interactions will be less. I'm so grateful for you and our accomplishments together. I have truly never felt a moment of so much pride and happiness as getting my baseball jersey retired. Who? Standing alongside my brothers by choice, I love you guys from the very bottom of my heart. Last, but definitely not least, I must thank my family. Jasmine, Robbie, Brianna, San, Tia Adrian, Uncle John, Jr., my grandparents, Pa, my dad, and even JoJo. I love you guys with all my heart, and I'm so thankful to have you guys in my life. Ooh, there it goes again. You stood by me my whole life, and I couldn't be grateful for the family God has given me. This one's whew. Above all, the real MVP in my life is my mom. My mom has always been there for me, more than anyone on this earth. And more than most moms. She's truly the most selfless person I know. Mom, you're my fortress, and I love you with all my heart. Whew. Thank you for always encouraging me, for celebrating the good times, and crying with me through the bad. I can honestly talk forever, and I would never be able to thank you enough for all you did and all you'll do. Yeah. In closing, Bernie Siegel once said, God wants us to know that life is a series of beginnings, not endings, just as graduations are not terminations, but commencements. Creation is an ongoing process, and when we create a perfect world where love and compassion are shared by all, suffering will cease. RCA is the only school I've ever known. I've always had the same teachers, staff, and schoolmates. RCA is not perfect, just as we are not perfect. Nothing is. But RCA is something no other school has. It has a sense of family. This school has made me the person I am today. Here, I have learned all I need to know to be prepared for a world of higher education. But way more importantly than that, I have learned about life. About forming friendships and accepting others for their differences. I have learned that there is a place in the world for all kinds of people, but most of all, I have learned the value of making God the center of my life. I will forever call this place my one true home. Thank you, and God bless Redland Christian Academy.
An excellent representative of your class. Thank you, Michael. We're really lucky tonight that all the students who are going to be addressing you are excellent representatives of your class. So keep your tissues out for your valedictorian, Nicholas Aguirre.
Thank you. I am overwhelmed with emotions as I stand before you today. I feel so privileged to be given the valedictory, to deliver the valedictory speech on behalf of the class of 2015. I am humbled by the title and I am grateful for the experience. Thank you. First and foremost, I would like to extend my heartiest congratulations to my fellow graduates present here tonight. Together we have been... Together we have been through quite a journey and it has indeed been an enriching and memorable experience. We stand here today on the precipice of the future. It is not a distant dream anymore. It is a present reality. Everything we have dreamed of, everything we have planned for, it begins right here, it begins today. We began high school as children, but we're leaving here as adults. We have completed the basic education that will serve as a platform we will use to launch ourselves into our futures. Some of us will go on to college. Others will go straight into the workforce, but each of us will travel our own path. It is an honor for me to be here. I know that many of you, both graduates and parents, have been waiting for this day for many years, and here it is. Steve Jobs once said, "You can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards." So you have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something, your gut, destiny, life, karma, or whatever it may be. Because believing that the dots will connect down the road will give you the confidence to follow your heart, even when it leads you off the well-worn path. And that will make all the difference. We have been given such rich opportunities to explore. We have been given a safe and happy environment to take risks. We have been allowed to travel off the path and find ourselves, and for that reason, I believe we can overcome any obstacle. I implore you to continue traveling off the path, to continue dreaming, to continue taking chances, because if we don't, we're wasting our potential. My friends and I have overcome many obstacles to get where we are today. And it brings me back to 6 years ago and the humble beginnings of our district championship baseball team. When we were in the process of building a baseball team, none of us really knew how we were going to accomplish the task at hand. The dots seemed to be scattered all over the place, but looking back, our team was meant to be the one that would win a championship in 2015. Back in 2007, we had the pleasure to be introduced to Coach Tonso Lide. Where you at? Oh, there you are. Who has been with us since the very beginning. Step by step, Coach Lide went from teaching us the basics of playing the game of baseball to outreaching and collecting funds to expand the team. He not only taught us to play, he taught us to do so with commitment, confidence, determination, and intensity. Most importantly, he taught us to give all glory to God for giving us these opportunities. He taught us that when we played, we not only played to represent Redland Christian Academy, but we also played to represent God. He taught us to have him present in our hearts and in our lives and in everything that we do. I would like to take the opportunity to congratulate the Redland Christian Academy Falcons baseball team for the 2015 district championship victory. Looking back, all the dots are connected. We could not connect the dots looking forward 6 years ago. Yet today, I see the beautiful picture that the dots form behind me. We have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in our individual futures as well. We have to trust God to help us connect them. And this will make all the difference in our lives. Our parents have been the biggest influence on our lives. They are one of the most important factors in our development. And I want to take the opportunity to thank all the parents today. Thank you for your understanding and your constant support. Thank you for raising us. Thank you for all the sacrifices that you've made for us. Thank you for all the love that you've given us. We love you and we thank you for all that you've done. It's hot. As I reminisce the past, I remember my teachers who patiently and diligently taught and helped me in reaching my goals. Mrs. Cabrera, Mr. Buskirk, Mrs. Keating, Mrs. Friebel, and Coach Enlon, I may not have had you as one of my teachers. However, my classmates shared with me how each one of you have made a positive impact on them, I do wish to take the time to thank you for all that you've done for our school. That's the second time. AIM team, your goal of seeing lives radically transformed by God is admirable, and I thank you for all the sacrifice that you guys made for my peers and I. I value your mission and appreciate your hard work and dedication. Thank you for everything that you do. Mike and Rob, where are you guys at? Oh, really? Last summer, I visited the school on several occasions for several different reasons. On almost every occasion, I noticed you both were here. I saw you selling chocolates and moving furniture. I saw you painting the building and hanging out with students. I saw you talking to each other and praying together. On one of those visits to the school, I looked over at one of my teachers and asked, "Do they pretty much live here?" And she simply answered, "Yes, they basically do." It was in that moment that I realized how much you sacrifice for this ministry. It's not just a job or a hobby for you. It is your entire lives. I hope in the future that I find a cause that inspires such passion in me. Thank you for giving your entire lives to us. Your efforts are noticed, even if they aren't as acknowledged as they should be. Mr. Antiola, thank you for teaching me and helping me in reaching my academic goals. Even though I've only had you for half a year, I learned a lot with you. Thank you. Mrs. Campbell, I had the opportunity to have you as a teacher for 1 year, and I thank you for all the diligence and work that you put in to teach our class. We learned a lot from you. Mr. Hain, where are you at? Oh, there you are. You are one of the most humorous, outgoing teachers that we have in school. You're also one of the most committed sports coaches that I've ever met. And I want to thank you for inspiring others to become better at what they do every single day. Miss Keating, I admire your passion for teaching, and even though you're not here anymore, I want to thank you for showing me the importance of consistency and responsibility. Mrs. Smith, where are you? Oh, I found you. To my former English teacher, who gave me difficult challenges to show how much I was capable of, thank you for everything. You've helped me a lot, especially with the fundamentals of English. I'm truly appreciative of everything you have done for my development. Mrs. Ramirez, where are you? I can't find you either. Oh, I found you. You have made my time here at school very special. You have supported me and pushed me to reach my goals. You are one of the most generous and selfless people I've ever met, and I want to thank you for everything. Mrs. Kobo, you are my first Bible teacher at the school. And I want to thank you for all of your patience. Thank you for giving me the strength and the courage to help me adjust and grow as a student and as an individual. Sorry, it's one of those tongue twisters. As an individual in a new environment, I've learned so much from you and your class. Coach Franklin, or as many of you know him as Audric, I want to thank you for always being there for me. And for not only being a good physical education teacher, but also a good friend. What I have learned from you is how to be an independent leader in the world of sports through effective communication, responsibility, and integrity. We all miss you deeply and wish you can come back. Tanya, where are you? Oh, I found you. You were the first person that I met when I came to the school 7 long years ago. It's amazing how you have a special bond with every child. Students come to you when they need to know about any upcoming events or when they just simply need a Band-Aid. You often dry tears and heal wounds. Parents call you with questions and you have every single answer. Tanya, I want to thank you for everything that you do. I also want to take the opportunity to thank Fiorella for her support in the office. You guys make a great team. Mrs. Cuesta. Is she here tonight? Oh, I found you. I've never had the opportunity to have you as my teacher. However, I know you're an amazing one. On behalf of my classmates and I want to thank you for that. I admire how you treat each student with respect, you care about every student, and you're able to see the positive in every child that walks into your room. You motivate and inspire every student, never giving up. Because of your perseverance, you always succeed. Thank you for all the advice and support you have provided me with. I know that I can come and talk to you about anything. Aside from being a teacher, I consider you a true friend. Dr. Ruffin, let's do some math. You have made such a positive impact on me throughout these years. You've affected and changed me in so many ways that it is hard to single out a few. Under your teaching and your influence, I've become more determined and independent. You have changed the way that I think about mathematics. Surprisingly, I used to despise math, and it used to be my weakest subject. Through you, I was able to acquire a love for math, and I am confident it will continue to grow as I get older. Today, all of my future goals are centered on mathematics-centered careers. Thank you for showing how much you care and for being there for me. Thank you for being an amazing teacher. Mrs. Bryant, where do I even begin? You've been my teacher for the past 2 years, and I feel that I've learned so much from you. And one of the most important things that I have learned and admired from you is that you have shown me to have Christ in everything that I do. From you, I've learned to open my mind and to think creatively, to understand how important it is to have a higher education, to have goals, and to have the fortitude to achieve those goals. Every time that I felt the need for advice, you've always been there for me. I can always come to you not only as my teacher, but also my friend. Your devotion to Christ and your selflessness are qualities that I truly admire from you. Thank you for your support and your dedication on what you do. Mr. Carrillo, I have known you for the past 6 years. There really are no words to express my gratitude to you for all that you do. I'm extremely thankful that you're my teacher. I thank you for being so consistent in class. You are one of the most knowledgeable teachers that I've had. Thank you for the sacrifices that you made to teach me to the best of your ability. Thank you for the times you have given real and honest feedback to me. You have taught me so many important things about American government and about American history and geography, world history. But most importantly, you taught me how to get a girl's number. Coach Tonso lied. There are so many great memories that have been created throughout the 7 years that you have been coaching the baseball team. Thank you, Coach Lied. It really is a great feeling to have the opportunity to look back at the time where everything started. On behalf of my team and myself, I'd like to thank you for developing us into young baseball players. Thank you for the time you sacrificed from your personal life to coach us, your adopted family, during the baseball season. Thank you for your dedication to teaching a game that you love, which led us to develop that same love for the sport. Thank you for the fact that you not only taught us about baseball, but about life through the game of baseball. Thank you for the way you encourage us, your players, when we were playing through the good and through the bad. Thank you for treating us with the same level of care, concern, and love that you do with your very own kids. I also want to thank Coach Kenny, Coach Mariano, and Coach Liao for your support, advice, and dedication with the baseball team. Mrs. Bergman, it's not often that people take the time to say thank you. In fact, it's rare for people to even think about how others have impacted their own lives. I would like to let you know how appreciative I am to have you as our principal. You have been the greatest supporter of this school's athletic department. Your decisions are based always on what's best for our school, our students, and our teachers. Thank you for giving us much needed advice for educating the youth today, for shaping the future generation, for making sacrifices they're planning, and for taking up a profession so selfless. You have been a great principal, mentor, and example for me. Thank you for all of your advice, encouragement, and support. Finally, to all of you graduates sitting here by me, with whom I share so many fond memories with, together we have laughed, we have learned, we've gotten into trouble, we have loved, and most of all, we have grown up. More specifically, we've grown up together. In the future, we will meet new people, make new friends, and learn new things from them. We will grow older, more responsible, and independent. The true measure of friendship is how people can grow up, can grow differently without growing apart. I'm confident our friendships will measure up to the best. Thank you for your friendship. I hope that as we end this chapter of our lives, you are all prepared to write the next chapter. I wish you all the best of the best. Good luck and congratulations to class of 2015.
Dakota Meredith put that slideshow together for you guys. So thanks, Cody.
Teachers and graduates, please stand for the awarding of the diplomas. Nicholas Joseph Aguirre. Kenya Brown. Jordan Flores. Eddie Gonzalez. Rudy Reynel Guillen. Keandra Roundtree. Michael Adam Salas. Emily Amanda Sierra. Gabriel Valdivia Jr. Graduates, please stand. You may now take your tassels from the right to the left. We present to you the graduating class of 2015.
Thank you.
Congratulations, graduates, and thank you, parents.